We're trying to create the first unicorn in Pakistan, a billion-dollar company. Okay, now that's not easy. Pakistan has been very good to me. You know, my identity is that of a Pakistani, but I hadn't given anything back to the country. So I was looking at what to do. My background is finance. I could, you know, go work for a commercial bank as a CEO, or I could do my own thing. And I came back to Pakistan and applied for a microfinance bank license. I didn't know microfinance at all. My team didn't know microfinance. But we were confident, not arrogant, but we were arrogant also. I'd come back to that, how we had to pay the price for that. And we started Tameer Microfinance Bank about 15 years ago.
We are ready for operation. So aaj asal mein Tameer bhi paidaish ka pehla
din. When we finished, Easypaisa, which was our joint product, Telenor, was ranked number 2 in the world. There were a few services, Pakistani services, which are ranked globally. Tameer Bank was the most profitable microfinance bank in Pakistan. We had raised capital from a telco, with the first instance of a telco buying a microfinance bank, so we had created a template. Through Easypaisa, we had changed people's lives. So it was a very satisfying experience, but it was also a risky one. I went all in. Whatever money I had made over a 27-year period, I put in Tameer. Okay, at that time, I could have gone bad, wrong. But with the grace of God, it didn't. And recently, actually after we exited, Tameer Bank was valued at $410 million by Alibaba, no less than just Alibaba. I'm very critical of the local banks. I say that they haven't invented a new product since the earth cooled. So they're not innovating, they're not increasing the total customer base. Total consumer lending in Pakistan is based on about 1.7 million people in a country of 200 million people. It takes 1 month to get a credit card. A new to bank customer takes a month. Enormous amount of paperwork, hassle. So there are less than 1.2 million credit cards in a country like Pakistan. So this is great news for people like us to disrupt these banks. From primary school, your parents and your teachers are programming you for a job. To be a doctor, to be a banker, to be a lawyer. No one's at the grassroots level saying, hey, you should be an entrepreneur. So your building is this bias against entrepreneurship. What is it, about 55-60% of the Pakistani population is under 25. So if you look at the number of students graduating every year, there's no way the traditional services or the industry can absorb them. There are two stages where it's easy to become, relatively easy to become an entrepreneur. Straight out of college, because you're staying with mom and dad, your clothes are being pressed, you're getting food, you've got shelter, and you don't have any other expenses, so there's very little risk to take. On the other side, you don't have any experience, but entrepreneurial experience is not equal to working in a company experience, very different animal. Or at the time that I started to change careers, that you've got some amount of wealth, theoretically you could keep some on the side, you're not putting everything at risk. Mid-career is the most difficult. One wife, one husband, 1.2 children, 3 mortgages, car financing, insurance. Being an entrepreneur is not easy. It's not everybody's cup of tea. You've got to be resilient. Entrepreneurship is about resilience. You fall down and you got to stand up again. You're going to go through cash burns. You're going to miscalculate your cash burn. You're going to run out of money. You're going to figure out, how you're going to manage your expenses, shrink them. Have confidence. Don't be arrogant, but have confidence. Don't look back. I never look back. You got to keep thinking big, but execute small. You need to understand your market. And I get people coming here, I said, okay, what's your competition? We don't know. We are unique. Nobody's unique. Competitiveness or comparative advantage is fleeting. The moment you create something, somebody else trying to replicate that. The moment we created Easypaisa, There were five other people trying to replicate what we did. It's my heartfelt desire that large business houses start looking at this industry. You know, $1 million is nothing for them. So even if they invested $1 million in a seed fund, it would greatly help this ecosystem. This is a great time to invest in Pakistan, notwithstanding all our economic problems, but still huge potential in this country. By 2020, 90% of Pakistan is going to be in a 3G, 4G coverage. By 2020, probably 60 to 65 million smartphones. Now, this is huge. This is a revolution. So imagine, a smartphone is a hospital, it's a bank, you know, it's an entertainment center. It can be multiple of things. So in a remote part of Pakistan, in Zob, we can provide tuition, we can provide diagnostic stuff. They are now connected to Sana Safi Naz if they want to make an order. So this connectivity is going to bring millions of people into this market who are going to be spending either on education or on diagnostic or on entertainment or on, you know, e-commerce. And that's the wave that you want to ride. Second is the demographics. We've got this huge young cohort. We are the largest cohort, one of the largest cohorts in the world. And these people are weaned on technology. They want to scratch their head, they look at the app. Is there an app that can help me scratch my head? And therefore, you're going to get access to them. They don't want to, you know, work on the old technology ways. Thirdly, we have such low valuations. We haven't got inflated valuation. Had I sold Tameer Bank in my neighboring country, you know, it would have been a very different story. I would have got at least 5 to 10 times the multiple that we got over here. My pitch always is, this is the time to ride this wave. And you come in now, and you know, when the valuations get to the level comparable to our, you know, our neighbor, huge upside. And the first year that we had was phenomenal, 20,000 new customers, zero default. And we drank our own Kool-Aid so much, we figured out that we knew microfinance. We were blue-eyed Citibank bankers who walked on water and didn't get wet. And next year, our delinquency went up to 25%. We were so arrogant that, you know, we didn't understand the market dynamics. And, you know, we paid the price for that. The 25% delinquency and normal cash burn, our capital started getting eroded very fast. The lesson that was, be more humble, okay? Sometimes that's difficult for people who've been successful in their careers, and, you know, they think they know everything. But life teaches you a lot of lessons. Interaction with young people. You know, I surround myself with people who are eager, smarter than I am, hungry, you know, but need some discipline, need some wisdom, you know, need to be grounded as such. So it's exciting introducing new technology. It's exciting changing the way, you know, Easypaisa changed the way people did remittance, made life so much easier for people. So we're creating stuff which can get scaled and watch it develop, you know, is exciting.